120 to 134. These 15 psalms are called psalms of ascents. As we have seen, they were used by the Jews for their pilgrimage to Jerusalem. So the psalms of ascents, so the ascents actually is going up to Jerusalem, the pilgrim way. Okay, 131. It's a very simple psalm. Just three verses. Okay. Oh Lord, my heart is not lifted up. My eyes are not raised to God. I do not occupy myself with things too great and too marvelous for me. I have calmed and quieted my soul like a weak child with his mother. My soul is like a weak child that is with me. All his right, hope in the Lord from this time on and forevermore. O Israel, hope in the Lord from this time on and forevermore. See how touching this psalm is. Friends, Psalm 131. The message of this psalm goes well with the message of Psalm number 130. 130 verse 7, take 130 verse 7. O Israel, hope in the Lord. You see, that is the invitation in Psalm number 130. O Israel, hope in the Lord. Take Psalm number 131 verse 3. O Israel, hope in the Lord. You see, O Israel, hope in the Lord. Actually, this is a psalm of hope. A psalm of hope. A psalm of trust. A psalm of humility. Humility, then quietness and hope. These would be the key themes of this psalm. Humility, then quietness and hope. Okay. You know, most of the commentators consider Psalm number 131 as a song written by a woman. A psalm written by a woman. Psalm number 131, why they might have considered it, or why they considered it as written by a woman. Why?
Father, verse 2, it says that, but I have calmed and quieted my soul like a child quieted at its mother's breast.
Yes.
And that is the, I believe that is the reason why.
Yes. That is the reason, because you see this feminine language, a symbol, that is very striking, very strong. And there is another point that we will come to it. There is another writer who mentions another point to do that, but that we will do later. And you know, there are also other passages in the Bible where the songs of women are mentioned. 1 Samuel chapter 2. 1 to 10, that is the song of Hannah. which I inspired the Marian song, Magnificat Anima Mea, okay, Dominum, which is in Luke 147:55. You see, in Exodus itself, Exodus chapter 15, verses 20 and 21, there you see, after the song of the sea sung by Moses, it is mentioned, Miriam sung a song, just two lines, okay, with the drums and all. They sing and dance. And Miriam, the sister of Moses, composed a song. And in Judith chapter 16, verses 1 to 7, you find is another song, you see, by a woman. So, Psalm number 131, considering it as a song of woman. But you know, you see the title, Shir Hamalut Lidavid. Lidavid. There even the name of David is mentioned. Okay. As you know, the titles are not the original portion of the Psalms. Titles were added at the moment of the collection of various Psalms. So that is the editor's note. The titles are editor's note. So, Shir HaMahalot LeDavid, okay, the song of ascents of David. And even that of David, what does it mean? What does the editor understand? What does he think when he writes of David, LeDavid? Is it a lambda auctoris? Is it pointing to the authorship? Or is it pointing to the as a concerning David, meaning concerning David? We don't know, or for David. We don't know, we have no idea, because Lambeth can have various meanings. Good. And friends, you see this imagery of a little child with a mother. That's a beautiful imagery, proper for a pilgrimage. Because pilgrimage was done as a family. Altogether, they do. At the age of 12, Jesus, okay, and his parents, okay, they went to Jerusalem temple. And you see, they think, the parents think that Jesus would be with the co-travelers. You see, so that's a big group where there are parents, children, little ones, bigger ones, younger ones, okay, there are. So, a child with a mother, okay, that's a good imagery, proper for a pilgrimage. Okay, that's fine. And you see, in the book of, in the Psalms of Ascents, we can clearly see reference to families and the little ones. Yes, there are. For example, Psalm number 122, verse 8. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God. For the sake of my relatives and friends, I'll say, peace be with you. You see, for the sake of my relatives and friends, my relatives, my family, families, okay? For the sake of my family and my friends, you see that family. Okay, and see 127:3-5. Sons are indeed a heritage from the womb, and the fruit of the womb a reward. Like arrows in the hand of the Lord, and the sons of what? You see, children are mentioned. Okay, sons are mentioned. And 128:3-6. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. You see the family and children mentioned in Psalm 128. Also, 133:1. How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. You see the family unity. So family and children, okay, that's highlighted. in the Psalms of Ascent. Okay, good. That which is a kind of introduction. Psalm number 131. And so, three verses. You know, there are three Psalms with three verses in the Psalter. So 131, 133 and 134, these are the three Psalms with three verses. Okay, fine. So, Psalm number 131, verse 1 speaks about the humility of the Psalmist. Whereas verse 2 speaks about the quietness, the meekness, okay, of the soul. And verse 3 is an invitation to hope, hope, humility, quietness, and hope. Okay, good. Now let us focus on verse 1. Verse 1. Lord, my heart is not lifted up. My heart is not lifted up. Then, there are three negations, you know? There are three verbs in verse 1 with the negations. Three verbs with the three negations, which are they? Not lifted up. Then, secondly, not raised too high. And thirdly, not occupied also with great things. Okay? So, three verbs with the negations. Three negations. Good. Now what about, first let us go to the heart of the talk. The heart talk. Okay. And then there are eyes talk. Okay, the eyes. That's heart lev. Okay, lev. Heart can mean also mind. Okay, lev can mean heart or mind. Thank you. Okay, so it points to the interiority. Interiority. That's clear. So that points to the thought dimension. Okay, thinking dimension, thought dimension. About the heart, you see. Proud heart. About proud heart. First Samuel, chapter 2, verse 3.
Do not keep talking so proudly, or let your mouth speak such arrogance. For the Lord is a God who knows, and by Him deeds are weighed.
Okay, so do not speak arrogantly or proud things. You see, heart, haughty heart, okay, that is clearly a symbol of a pride, arrogance, okay, it's clear. Psalm number 101, verse 5.
Whoever slanders a neighbor in secret, I will put to silence. Whoever has haughty eyes and a proud heart, I will not tolerate.
The proud heart, I will not tolerate. I will not tolerate. You see, a lot of passages we can say. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 5. All those who are arrogant are an abomination to the Lord. Be assured they will not go unpunished. So there are a lot of texts. It's okay. Leave that. We come to exactly, you know, 16:5. This is exactly Gabach Lev. Gabah, the same phrase we have here. Okay, Gabah Lev. Okay, now about eyes. Einayim. Ayin. Ayin is eye. And Einayim, eyes, plural. Okay, actually it is dual rather than plural. It is dual. In Hebrew, you know, you see hand. Yad, Yadayim, Ain Ainaim. Otsan Otsnaim. Regal put Reglaim. So double. Double. That is dual actually. Good. Now I is open to the world. So exteriority. I is the symbol of exteriority. Okay. Heart interiority and I exteriority. Psalm number 18, verse 27.
For you deliver a humble people, but the haughty eyes you bring down.
Haughty eye. Here, exactly the same phrase is there. Einayim ramot. Einayim ramot. Okay. This is the same as in 131, 1827. You see, for you deliver a humble people, but the haughty eyes you bring down. Haughty eyes you bring down. Okay. Now, in the book of Proverbs, chapter 6, interestingly, there are six things elencated or enlisted. Okay. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 17.
Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood.
Well, would you please begin one verse earlier, then it would be better.
Okay. Yeah. Things that the Lord hates, seven that are an abomination to him. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood.
A heart that devises wicked plans.
Feet that hurry to run to evil.
A lying witness
who testifies falsely, and one who sows discord in a family.
Yeah, you see, 16 to 19, six things elencated, you see, and one is haughty eyes. Okay, Einayim Ramot. Einayim Ramot, exactly the same phrase. So, in short, the psalmist is saying, in my thoughts and in my actions, okay, I am humble, O Lord. Okay, that's a good declaration before the Lord. My heart is not proud, my eyes are not haughty. Okay, then the psalmist says, you see, I do not occupy myself with things too great and too marvelous for me. Literally, it is, I do not walk, halak, I do not walk in gudolot, big things, uvneflaot, and in marvelous things, miraculous things, I do not walk. You can even say, you see, I do not occupy myself with things too great and too marvelous for me. Okay, actually, what is this gedolot? These big things. What are these marvelous things, niflaot? Most of the scholars say that these gedolot and niflaot point to the intellectual pride. Okay, intellectual pride. Yes. Oh, I deal with great things, you see. You see, I know everything. I am self-sufficient. I am omniscient. Okay, omniscient, self-sufficient, all this. You see, intellectual or psychological self-sufficiency. Okay. And you see, speaking about great things as if one knew everything. And some people say, actually, Job's sins of which he had to repent. Okay, were such gudolot, such great things. Please read Job chapter 40, verses 1 to 5.
And the Lord said to Job, "Shall a fault finder contend with the Almighty? He who argues with God, let him answer it." Then Job answered the Lord, "Behold, I am of small account. What shall I answer you? I lay my hand on my mouth. I have spoken once, and I will not answer twice, but I will proceed no further."
"I have spoken once, but I will not answer anymore. Oh, I stop. I stop. I lay my hand on my mouth. See, what I have been speaking till now, oh, that is a folly. I stop it." Okay, you see, that's it. Take 42, 1 to 6. There you see exactly these gidolot. These niflaot. Yeah.
"Then Job answered the Lord, 'I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore, I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Hear, and I will speak. I will question you, and you declare to me. I had heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eyes sees you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes.'"
Okay, you see, who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? "Therefore, I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me." That is niflaot. Okay, miraculous things, marvelous things. Okay, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. But now I stop. See, that's it. The scholars find that, you see, this attitude, that is, "I am not entitled to speak or think about the great things," okay? Please check Deuteronomy 29:29. So, the spirit of Deuteronomy 29:29 is almost this: "The secret things belong to the Lord, our God, but the revealed things belong to us." You see, the secret things belong to the Lord, and the revealed things belong to us. So, there are secret things which we do not know, which we need not know. The secret things. The revealed things, of course, we should know. We know that. You see, I don't know, but this is an opinion of the scholars. Now, it is P.D. Miller who proposes another explanation for this. For him, both these, gidolot, the great things, and niflaot, that is, marvelous things, both these point to God's actions, God's creation, God's intervention, okay, great and marvelous. So, Miller says, this psalmist is a lady, and she, having accepted for herself the patriarchal system's insistence that women, okay, are not entitled to look into the serious things of God. Serious things means the theological matters, the patriarchal system. Okay, so the patriarchal system of that time had convinced women that they have no role in theology, in interpreting, in understanding, in studying. Okay, that is what P.D. Miller says. Okay, now the second verse, let us go to the second verse of 131. But I have calmed and quieted my soul like a weaned child with its mother. My soul is like the weaned child that is with me. Okay, here the psalmist is presenting the quietness and the trusting dimension of a believer in God. You see, there are two verbs, okay? One is shaviti, I think. Let me check. Yes, that's it. Imlo shiviti shava, imlo shiviti vudumamti napshi. Okay. You know, damam, okay, that verb usually points to the silence and quietness before the Lord's presence. Damam. Psalm number 4, verse 4, 31:17, 37:7, 62:5, Isaiah 23:2, all these passages, okay, use this verb damam in the sense of almost a meditational line before the Lord, a contemplative line before the Lord. Okay. And there is a symbol used. That is a weaned, that of a weaned child. Weaned child. Gamul. Kagamul. Like a weaned child. Okay. And you can see this gamul, this expression in 1 Samuel 1. 23 and 24.
Then Elkanah said to her, "Do what seems best to you. Wait until you have weaned him. Only may the Lord establish his word." So the woman remained and nursed her son until she weaned him. Then she had him.
Okay, that weaned child. You see, actually, a child which is not weaned, that is still nursing child, okay, that child will be clinging on to the mother because he or she needs milk. Okay. But a weaned child, you see, cling on to the mother, it is more for love, closeness. You see, accompaniment. You see, so weaned child. Actually, this is a symbol. Oh Lord, actually, he is speaking about his soul with him is like a weaned child. But in fact, this weaned child imagery leads us to God. The quietness in the presence of God. Weaned child. Humility in the presence of God. Now, quietness in the presence of the Lord. Okay? That is a beautiful imagery. Now, verse 2 we have seen. And in verse 2, we can find it is, it leads to verse 3, and it also, that means the weaned child, okay, who clings on to the mother, like that, see, the psalmist is clinging on to God. Because you are my hope. So, in verse 3, there is the invitation to hope. O Israel, hope in the Lord from this time on and for evermore. Okay. Would you please take Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 31.
And in the wilderness, where you saw how the Lord your God carried you, just as one carries a child, all the way that you travel until you reach this place.
See, God carrying you just as one carries a child. See, that imagery in Deuteronomy is so beautiful. Would you please take Isaiah chapter 66, verse 13.
As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem.
Okay. As a mother comforts a child, I shall comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. Okay. So, in all these, there are the imagery of God as father and the imagery of God as mother. For example, Isaiah chapter 49:15 is a beautiful passage which we all know to show the motherly aspect of God. Yes, Isaiah 49:15.
And a woman forget her nursing child, or show no compassion for the child of her womb. Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you.
Oh, that's great. That's great. I will not forget you. Even if your mother forgets you. Okay, so God as more than mother. Not simply God as mother, but God as more than mother. Okay, and you see, it is the hope of Israel. So actually, the whole Psalm number 131, is pointing to the hope of Israel. As we saw in 130 verse 7, hope of Israel. And towards the end we have, from now on forever. Okay, and that is a phrase repeated in the Psalms of Ascents, also, I would say four or five appearances, say of the same phrase, 113 verse 2, 113 verse 2, 115 verse 18, 121 verse 8, 125 verse 2. Okay, that is that much. So we have completed the exegesis, exegetical part of Psalm number 131. Now let me see how you are going to connect it to Christ and Christology, and also to ecclesiology or spirituality. You see, the trust, hope, quietness, humility. See, we see actually that the life of Jesus as a life of humility, a life of quietness, and a life of hope, all on account of the Father. He was always listening obeying the will of the Father, and always calm and quiet, meek and humble of heart. And he hoped even the very cross, you see, even the very cross. Actually, the resurrection was the realization of the hope of Jesus. God has raised him. So that is Psalm number 31. The fullness of the whole theme can be found in the life and teachings of Jesus Christ. Now, what about the spiritual application? What about Psalm number 131 related to our lives? Childlikeness. The psalm invites us all to a childlike life. Matthew 18, 1 to 4. Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever becomes humble, you see, humility is a part of Psalm number 131. And Jesus uses the same word. Okay, whoever becomes humble like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Okay, so humility of a child. Oh, okay, it's time now.
Father, can I just say something about this psalm? To me, when I look at this, it's I am in prayer right before you, my Lord. My heart is not proud. I'm looking at you, but my eyes are not raised above that. Even though I have storm in my heart, my Lord, I have calmed myself as a child because I have the trust in you. I hope in you. I know that you will take care of my things. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. That was the prayer proper for this conclusion of this class. Okay. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And the Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you. God bless you.